يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم سورة آل عمران This blessed surah, surah number 3 in the Quran that great benefits and lessons for us to learn that things happen at the time of the Prophet ﷺ major things that happen at the time of the Prophet ﷺ Quran was revealed to correct some of the things that happened, to teach the Ummah of the Prophet ﷺ how to be steadfast facing their enemies, and what are the means of success in this life and in the hereafter, showing the believers the unseen through the verses in the Qur'an, what happens to the martyrs if they are steadfast and they fight for the sake of Allah, for those who make the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala superior, what happens to them, whether in matters of this life facing their enemies and the plots of their enemies, and whether they, when they are steadfast for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them victory, whether in this life they would see it with their own eyes, or if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take their lives and they die for the sake of Allah, they get the great rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being martyred and so on. Towards the end of the surah, Surat Al-Imran, the verses will talk about or sums for us the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth, the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth, and one of which the means to be steadfast, especially living at a time or living at an environment where the believers are faced with so much of the tribulations and the calamities and the tests facing the disbelievers, those who are their enemies, they're trying to cause harm to them, they're trying to defeat them. And they try to defeat the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would make his religion superior. And the believers are sent, and they have a mission on the face of earth, and that is to make the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala superior. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevate their levels. And this is what we would see, inshallah ta'ala, in these verses in Surah Al-Imran from verse 175 to 177. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in verse number 175, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إنما ذلكم الشيطان يخوف أولياءه فلا تخافوهم وخافون إن كنتم مؤمنين which means that is only shaitan, Satan, who frightens you of his supporters. So fear them not, but fear me if you are indeed believers. This is of course related to the previous verses. In the battle of Hamra al-Asad that we talked about last time, when the companions radiallahu anhum with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they returned from the battle of Uhud with their wounds and those who were martyred and so on, and immediately before they would even rest, the call from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and as a result of that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered them, called them to go out again to fight the enemies, those who decided to come back and try to defeat the believers. So to go out against them with their wounds. And the Prophet ﷺ ordered only those who fought in the battle of Uhud, nobody else to come from those who chose to stay behind in Medina, only those who fought with the Prophet ﷺ. So some of them, they were carried because of their wounds, and they still went out to fight for the sake of Allah, to respond to the call from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without even looking at the means. The means says, for those who are wounded, they can just stay behind. But because the order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came, they have nothing but to submit themselves. And as a result of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them victory. They didn't fight. Allah put fear in the hearts of the disbelievers, then they fled away. So the believers, they won the battle without fighting in it, and they get the great rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of their submission to the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then this verse comes to teach the believers a great lesson, that the one that they should fear only is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That the shaitan, their everlasting enemy, his way is to get them to fear other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So be careful, because shaitan will try to do this and install that in your heart. So make sure that you purify your heart, you clean your heart from any fear except the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. So the ayah says, إِنَّمَا ذَلِكُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ يُخَوِّفُ أَوْلِيَاهُ. إِنَّمَا, every time we hear this إِنَّمَا, and it's many verses in the Quran starts with that word, it gives the exclusiveness of what comes afterwards. So this is something that is very exclusive. إِنَّمَا ذَلِكُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ, that verily, indeed, that is it, that the shaitan, ذَلِكُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ, it is the shaitan, is the Satan, your everlasting enemy, the one that refused to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the angels to prostrate. And as a result of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the shaitan the ability to whisper to the human beings. He gave him the ability to live till the day of judgment by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to whisper to the human beings, to divert them from the steadfastness, from the salat al-mustaqim, to make them deviants, disbelievers, sinners, and so on. So the ways of shaitan is to bring this in the hearts of the believers, to bring the deficiencies in matters of tawheed, matters of belief, and one of which to fear other than Allah, since the fear of Allah is one of the acts of worship that people should have only for the sake of Allah. So إِنَّمَا ذَلِكُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ يُخَوِّفُ أَوْلِيَاءَ. يُخَوِّف, make you fear. أَوْلِيَاءَ, make you fear his supporters, make you feel the supporters of the shaitan. There is أولياء الرحمن and there is أولياء الشيطان. There is أولياء of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and there is أولياء of the shaitan. أولياء, supporters, helpers, those who they would stand up for whatever their master would order them, and so on. So أولياء الله subhanahu wa ta'ala, the believers are the supporters of the orders of Allah. They are the ones that makes the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala superior. And أولياء الشيطان are the disbelievers, the sinners, the criminals, those who commit injustices, they are followers of the shaitan. They make the words of shaitan superior. What is the words of shaitan? The words of corruption, the words of disbelief, the words of killing and hurting and so on. The words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we see in the Quran and in the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So it's a way that for the reciter of the Quran to choose whether to be among awliyaullah, the people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or to be among the people of shaitan. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran who are the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. That indeed awliya Allah, the people of Allah, there's no fear for them, nor shall they grieve. Who are they? الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. Those who believe and they have the obedience of Allah, they have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. They are following the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is assuring the believers, be content, have the tranquility in your heart and the contentment and the happiness and the joy in this life, that it's only the shaitan trying to make you fear his supporters, his people. فَلَا تَخَافُوهُمْ وَخَافُونِ إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ. So should you listen to the shaitan? Should you respond to the whisper of the shaitan that makes you fear other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or should you do something else? Here comes the order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَلَا تَخَافُوهُمْ. Do not fear the people of shaitan. Do not fear the supporters of shaitan. Do not fear the disbelievers. Do not fear the sinners, the criminals, those who, the hypocrites, will call you to fear them. And as a result of that, for you to compromise your religion, to stay away from the orders of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, فَلَا تَخَافُوهُمْ. Do not fear them. وَخَافُونِ إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ. And fear me if you are believers. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, either or. Either you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, or you would fear other than Allah. A believer might have in his heart both, fear of Allah and fear of other than Allah. But that's a deficiency in matters of worship, because the fear is supposed to be the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Somebody might say, but it's a natural fear. We're all as human beings, it's a healthy way of living our life. When we fear something, we would take the means to protect ourselves from what we fear. So fearing the enemy just as a concept, is that is forbidden even if it's something that is in our nature? No. What is meant here that, yes, if the people would say that your enemy are gathering against you, they're trying to cause harm to you as a result of you being steadfast on the deen of Allah, there will be some fear present in the heart, but it means go forward with the orders of Allah. Don't let this fear stop you from being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't let this fear make you compromise the deen of Allah. We, even with the smallest or the smallest thing that you would think that it's not a major thing, still be steadfast in the orders of Allah. Whether in the context of fighting for the sake of Allah, as it happened to the companions radiallahu anhum, when the hypocrites told them, fear the enemies because you are wounded, you just came back from the battlefield, so stay behind and don't go out and fight them. Right? So this is a major issue. Or with our daily life and the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we are faced by this in many parts of the world. One of the greatest fitan now that is afflicting many of the Muslims, you are being told in many cases, do not hold fast to your religion because harm might afflict you. People might cause harm to you, the disbelievers, the sinners, right? Whatever people are living on any part of the world, this is something that is commonly happening throughout the Muslim world, and it's meant to be this way in the stage that we live in. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. He's preparing the ummah for what's coming ahead, preparing the ummah to lead the world. And as a result of that, the ummah would have to face calamities, as we would see in the Quran, down after some verses, on like verse number 179, that the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth is in such a way that calamities afflict them to separate the true believers from those who are weak, from those who are hypocrites. So when the people gather against the believers, then the believers should not fear anyone but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I want to repeat it over and over again. We need to make sure that we understand this concept, understand this meaning, so that we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. You're afraid you might lose some of your wealth, you might lose your life, you might lose your wife, your best friends, your loved ones, because they don't want you to be steadfast on the deen of Allah. Don't worry about all of this. Worry about only one thing, about the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fear no one but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it easy for you. This is again what La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah entitles. The religion is not just a matter of things that we choose if it fits our desires and our environments, if it makes our people happy with us, we do. But if certain things in the deen of Islam, we know for sure that this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, but we do not do it out of the fear of human beings, this is a deficiency. This is a disease in the heart that we need to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from. We need to seek help and strength from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that can give us that strength. Needs high and strong iman, of course. But as we get the assurance in the Qur'an, and this is the benefit of pondering over the Qur'an, don't worry. If you are truthful with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, you will be helped. Things is not as you think it is. It's not as difficult it is. You won't face so much of miseries. Actually, you will be a victorious and happy person on the face of earth, even if physically it doesn't look and appear this way. But Allah would bring in your heart the comfort and the ease and the happiness that will keep you steadfast at the moment of death, when the believers will be given the glad tidings. So it is nothing but the shaitan is trying to make you fear his supporters, his people, when they are weak, they are deficient. The shaitan always makes the believers think that the disbelievers, they control the world. They have all the means of power and success. You cannot defeat them. They are this and they are that. So what happens then to the believers? Some of them would compromise the deen of Allah. They try to fit in, right? This is all evil, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is what we need to look into the Quran. Are we going to benefit from the verses? Or is just verses that we just learn the meanings of it for some form of blessings in reciting them? No, this is a life-changing verses that fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Be steadfast on the deen of Islam and fulfill the orders of Allah and fear nobody but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this is the ubudiyyah, this is the covenant. فَلَا تَخَافُوهُمْ Do not fear them. وَخَافُونِي إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ And fear me if you are believers. So this is a condition for iman, a condition of faith. It's for people to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And also what it understood from the verse, that if people fear other than Allah, and as a result of that compromise their deen, and disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of the fear of human beings, that means there is deficiency in their iman. And if they have deficiency in their iman, that means they subject themselves to the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to perfect our iman. We need to complete our iman by asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness after fulfilling the tawheed. And one of the means and one of the meanings of tawheed, part of the tawheed, is to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Because when we understood that the tawheed means the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the oneness of lordship, the oneness in names and attributes of Allah. But when it comes to La ilaha illallah, the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, means there is every act of worship is to be done only for the sake of Allah. Salah, siyam, fasting, sujood, dua, everything. Can we make sujood to other than Allah? Of course, that's not permissible. It's shirk. It's associating partners with Allah. The same way when it comes to fear. Because fear is an act of worship. Since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to fear Him alone subhanahu wa ta'ala, then it's an act of worship. Is it permissible to fear other than Allah? The answer is no. We should not fear no one but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And be assured that if this is your heart, if this is your attitude, if this is your life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will aid you, will help you, will make it easy for you to be steadfast, to complete your tawheed, to complete your deen. We continue inshallah ta'ala with more of the ways of Allah on earth and the great benefits that benefit our hearts and our actions according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us in this blessed surah, Surat Al-Imran, right after the break. So stay with us inshallah.
فلا وربك لا يؤمنون حتى يحكموك فيما شجر بينهم ثم لا يجدوا في أنفسهم حرجا مما قضيت ويسلموا تسليما. There are three levels. Sister Umm Rayhan from Bahrain.
السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. Fahim from Sweden. السلام عليكم.
السلام عليكم شيخ. How are you?
الحمد لله. بارك الله فيك Fahim. May Allah bless you and your family.
Sheikh, I have one question.
Now, that is not allowed. Why isn't allowed? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man ghasha falaysa minna." He who deceives or betrays does not belong to us. He's not one of us. A person who is giving the sadaqah or leading the prayer does not have necessarily to be praying fard. Maybe he's praying the nafl, that is after the prayer, the two sunnah after dhuhr or after maghrib or after isha. And the follower, the imam, will be praying with the intention of offering the fard that he has missed. Okay, barakallahu fi.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. Still with the verses from 175 to 177 from Surat Al-Imran and the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And really every verse we can take a whole hour talking about it or even more. If we ponder over the meanings and try to apply that in our life, in many aspects of our life, we would see how deficient we are in many cases and how we need to seek strength and help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because we're weak unless we seek that strength from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and how the acts of worship done in our hearts is basically the foundation for all the different acts of worship that we need to fulfill. The deen of Al-Islam is not just some physical things that we do or certain things that we appear with. The foundation of that is the tawheed, the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What's present in the heart with the fear of Allah, the hope for the rewards from Allah, the truthfulness, the sincerity, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of that, if it's perfect, if it's done in the proper way, then our speech will be accordingly. Our actions will be accordingly. And we would enjoy really this life. We would enjoy it. But not enjoying necessarily only the physical things in it. We would enjoy this life being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being patient with the orders of Allah. This is the real joy if we would fulfill these meanings. as we heard in verse number 175 about the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and how this was practically done at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when they feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, Allah gave them victory, and Allah made them successful at all levels, at all means. Even if they were killed, they will become successful individuals when they return to the mercy of Allah. They become martyrs, and if they are still alive, Allah gave them victory. And this is what the believers, they said, as it's mentioned in Surah At-Tawbah, that the believers, they said that either we would gain or be successful and gain in this world and to defeat the enemies. قُلْ هَلْ تَرَبَّصُونَ بِنَا إِلَّا إِحْدَى الْحُسْنَيَيْنِ. Are you waiting for us for two things, two good things? Either to be martyred, and that's the highest level, or the second one is to win the battlefield and to have the booties of the war and so on. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in verse 176, another way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaching the believers that how to be steadfast on the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially when facing others and facing the enemies of the deen and so on. وَلَا يَحْزُنْكَ الَّذِينَ يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْكُفْرِ إِنَّهُمْ لَنْ يَضُرُّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَلَّا يَجْعَلَ لَهُمْ حَظًّا فِي الْآخِرَةِ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ. Which means, and do not be grieved, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by those who hasten into disbelief. Indeed, they would never harm Allah at all. Allah intends that He should give them no share in the hereafter, and for them is a great punishment. وَلَا يَحْزُنْكَ الَّذِينَ يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْكُفْرِ. وَلَا, do not. This is something forbidden for you. Do not do that. What is it? وَلَا يَحْزُنْكَ. Do not be in state of grief. Do not be sad. This is to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to the believers, to the companions radiallahu anhum, to each and every one of us at all times, at all levels. Do not grieve, do not be sad. وَلَا يَحْزُنْكَ الَّذِينَ يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْكُفْرِ. As a result of seeing those who يُسَارِعُونَ. يُسَارِعُونَ means they are in haste. They are as if in a race, they're running, fleeing. But to which direction? To the direction of disbelief. الَّذِينَ يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْكُفْرِ. Those who are haste into disbelief. Do not make them or cause for you to be sad or to grieve. It's a natural thing for the believers. When they see the disbelievers, it makes them sad that how they are not seeing the truth, that they would want goodness for them, they want them to be believers, and it grieves them, make them sad to see them. And this is something that the Prophet ﷺ did, and it's mentioned in many verses in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering the Prophet ﷺ, don't grieve. Everything is by the orders of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. You fulfill the orders of Allah, you take the means, you fulfill the orders of Allah when He ordered you to call them to the deen of Allah, to be kind and gentle to them while calling them to accept the truth and to be believers. Even when it comes to fighting for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and at the same time be content that the qadr, the destiny of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will prevail. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala know goodness in the hearts, He would guide them to do what is good, and He would guide them to be among the believers. But we as human beings, we do not know that till the matter is all over. Till the disbelievers die, whether in state of disbelief or matters of belief. If they die in the state of disbelief, we know for sure they didn't deserve to be believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala know best about their affairs. We do not say that while they're still alive. Why? Because they have the chance to repent. That's why the believers are forbidden from making decisions or deciding now who will be in Jannah and who will be in Hellfire specifically, or seeing a fierce enemy to the deen of Islam, a disbeliever, and an enemy to the deen of Islam. Some people sometimes they rush into saying that he is in Hellfire or he would receive the punishment of Allah. How would you know? Do we know the unseen? What if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide him to be among the believers before he dies? Everything is in the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we get to see that at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the worst or the fiercest enemies to the deen of Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them among the best human beings whatsoever when they embrace the deen of Islam, like Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, like Khalid ibn al-Walid radiallahu anhu, in the same context of verses that talks about the battle of Uhud in Surat Al-Imran, when he was among the disbelievers, and he was one of the reasons of the defeat or the loss that happened to the army of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Of course all of that is by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then after that, what happened to Khalid ibn Walid? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him to the deen of Islam. So, but those who die in the state of disbelief, then it is the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So your job, and this is, as the verse is talking to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, your job is to convey the message. Guidance is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The job of the messenger, the job of the followers of the messenger, is to convey the message with the heart's content that the guidance is in the hands of Allah. There's an implication to this. It means, since it's not your responsibility, guidance is not your responsibility, your responsibility is to convey the message, the proper message, in the proper way, without distorting the message. The implications of this is, be steadfast on the message. Don't change in the message. Don't hide things. There's no need for you to hide anything. Just convey it the way it is, in the proper way, according to the way of the Prophet ﷺ, following the people of knowledge. Of course, you start with the most important and then and so on and so forth. You take people gradually, right? But you have the knowledge, you convey the message, and be content, have the assurance that guidance is in the hands of Allah. Does it make the caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala successful or not? Is according to how many people accepted his message or not? This is not necessarily true. Human beings, they might see the success of a person by how many people embraced Islam with him. That he was the mean of so much guidance of so many people. MashaAllah, this is good. But this is not necessarily the criteria to know whether the person is good or not. The criteria is to fulfill our job and that's it. Our job is to convey the message in the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us. Guidance is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is comforting the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and teaching the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَلَا يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْكُفْرِ. Those enemies, they fighting a messenger of Allah. What is worst action that a person can do on the face of earth than fighting a messenger of Allah? Fighting against them and trying to kill them and so on. So don't grieve, O Messenger of Allah, when it comes to those who are in haste in matters of disbelief. And linguistically, the word here, يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْكُفْرِ. يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْكُفْرِ, they are in haste towards disbelief. But fi means in. It gives the sense that they are in so much haste and so much rush into matters of disbelief into its core. Not that they are basically going there with, you know, with slow motion or whatever. No, they are just going there, rushing, submitting themselves to matters of disbelief. Even if you see them like that, you can see a person going slowly to matters of disbelief, going slowly to the ways of the disbelievers. But no, here the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, do not grieve, do not be sad, even if they are rushing totally, full force, to matters of disbelief, to the ultimate disbelief, to the ultimate of injustices, and so on. إِنَّهُمْ لَنْ يَضُرُوا اللَّهَ شَيْئًا. Why? Because indeed, إِنَّهُمْ لَنْ يَضُرُوا اللَّهَ شَيْئًا. They would never harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by anything. The disbelievers, they think that they can harm the deen of Islam. They cannot do that. They can harm the Muslims, yes. They can harm the believers, but only apparently in this life. But in reality, any harm that afflicts a believer, if a person is patient, that elevates his level. If a person is steadfast on the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, martyred for the sake of Allah, they are among those who are martyrs, the best of the rewards. And if they are alive, they are patient, and they get the great rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so they are always victorious. The believers are always victorious. People might not see that in the immediate moment that they live in, but it definitely will be seen. And that's why patience. Patience till the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes. Whether you see it in your life or definitely it will be clear in the day of judgment. And who said that part of our religion is to see with our own eyes victory? This is not basically part of our religion. If it happens, mashallah, this is great. If it didn't happen, it does not change anything in the life and the steadfastness of the believers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, teaching the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions radiallahu anhum and ourselves, that the disbelievers, those who you are forbidden from fearing them, those that grieves you, that they are rushing and hastening towards disbelief, they would never cause harm to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. the Most High subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the creator and they are the creation. He is the most rich and they are the most in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They cannot even own that same breath that they would take to sustain their life. They don't own their hearts. If death comes unto them, they cannot prevent themselves from dying. If the moment where they sleep, they cannot push away sleep even. They become so helpless and so weak, and that's why we are ordered to ponder over these things. These enemies, these disbelievers, these tyrants, what happens to them when they don't sleep for a day or two? They crash. They fall asleep. They become helpless. They cannot help themselves. If somebody tries to cause harm to them, they cannot defend themselves. They are totally helpless. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created that in us? So that we humble ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one that is able and owner of all things subhanahu wa ta'ala. So why fear the enemies of Allah? Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, because indeed the disbelievers, those who rush in disbelief, they would not cause harm to anyone. They would not cause harm to the deen of Allah. The deen of Allah is always continues to be superior. At certain times people, when they become weak because of their sins, they turn away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them victory either in their life or generations to come. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showing His ways of on the face of earth. Why the disbelievers are left to commit injustices. Why the enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are left. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is leaving them to spread corruption on the face of earth, to spread injustices, killing and so on. Many people, they are confused with this. Read the Quran, my dear brothers. Why? Because you would find the matter so clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying one of the reasons why they are left in this short life that we live in. يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَلَّا يَجْعَلَ لَهُمْ حَظًّا فِي الْأَخِرَةِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want for them to have a share in the hereafter. He doesn't want for them to have a share of the goodness in the hereafter. Because the more they commit crimes and sins against the believers or whatever, the more they are immersing themselves into the punishment of Allah. Unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept their repentance if they repent during their life before they die. So one of the means for those who die in the state of kufr, for those who die in state of disbelief or the state of sin, that one of the reasons why is to increase their sins, to increase their punishment in the hereafter because of their own evil actions. And that's why one of the implications of sins is other sins. One of the bad effects of sins is that it leads the person to another sin. One of the punishment of sins is another sin. And that's why repentance is an immediate thing. We should not delay repentance, because if a person commits a sin, does not repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the punishment can come in this life. What is the punishment in this life? A strike from the skies? No, not necessarily. Fire in the hell, in this world? This is not the punishment. The punishment in this life, the worst punishment that can happen on the face of earth, is when the person is helped to commit another sin, to double the punishment in the hereafter, to continue in the path of sin, to be deviated from the truth, for the heart to be blocked so that the person is away from guidance. This is the worst punishment. And this is the concept that we as Muslims should implement by reciting the Quran. Again, this is the benefit of pondering over the verses of the Quran, so that we can get to know the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that would give us means of steadfastness. That for the disbelievers, the reason why they are left to do this is for them to increase their punishment and for them not to have any share in the hereafter. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ. And they will have and receive a severe torment, great torment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Day of Judgment as a result of their evil actions and fighting the Prophet, fighting the believers, killing the believers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from matters of disbelief. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us steadfastness on matters of the Deen of Islam. And we will continue inshallah ta'ala with these means of steadfastness, with the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth, as it's mentioned in the blessed surah of Al-Imran, right after the break. So stay with us inshallah.
Welcome to Tech Talk. I'm your host, Omar Shear. This season of Tech Talk, we will focus specifically on the internet.
A student would type their paper, and instead of handing me a hard copy of their paper, they would upload it to this learning system,
okay.
this e-learning system.
I have some great experience when it comes to technology, and in particular, internet technology. Call to action is something that we do in our day-to-day lives, and maybe we don't realize it. Now we want to discuss, after you have a product and you have a website and you have a way to communicate with your customers, which would be your email marketing system, now it's time to take the money from the customer.
Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala rasulillah, with verses 175 to 177 from Surat Al-Imran, and the means of steadfastness and the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth, that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He give us the understanding of these verses, that our life will change accordingly, that we benefit from the verses of the Quran so that we are not among those who are forgetful. Many of the Muslims today, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us all and to protect us from being in that state, in state of forgetfulness, not understanding the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth, and as a result of that, panicking, compromising when it comes to the deen of Allah, acting and believing and talking like the disbelievers. If a person is a believer, he's totally different with these concepts, with these meanings that are mentioned in the Quran. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He is ordering the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the companions radiallahu anhum, don't fear the people of the shaitan, don't fear the disbelievers, don't fear the enemies of Allah, because it's all only from the ways of shaitan. Do not fear them, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, you will be victorious. And assuring them, if you are believers, this is the covenant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And don't grieve when you see those who would rush in matters of disbelief. Doesn't mean that you leave them or stay away from them. Advise them, call them, convey the message, but know for sure that they would never cause harm to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the wisdom of Allah, why the disbelievers or the sinners or the transgressors are left to spread the corruption on the face of earth, why is that? One of which, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want a share of goodness for them in the hereafter. And when the believers are suffering, when the believers are being faced with calamities and afflictions, that elevate the levels. How would a human being see this? It's only through the wahi, through the revelation from Allah. Human beings, they don't see that with their state of forgetfulness. That's why we need to seek the guidance from the book of Allah, the Quran. Then after that, in verse 177, also shows the ways of the disbelievers and means of steadfastness for the believers. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَوُوا الْكُفْرَ بِالْإِيمَانِ لَنْ يَضُرُّوا اللَّهَ شَيْئًا وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ, which means, indeed, those who purchase disbelief in exchange for faith, never will they harm Allah at all, and for them is a painful punishment. Again, more, with regards to the disbelievers, this struggle, the everlasting struggle between the believers and the disbelievers, between the truth and falsehood, this is the nature of this life. That for the believers to understand the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth, for them to always choose to be among the people of the truth, and to hold fast to the truth, and to apply the truth, and you will be faced with falsehood. You will be faced sometimes maybe with the people of falsehood. They will try to get you out of being among the people of the truth. They would threaten you. They would try to cause harm to you. So what should you do? Should you leave the deen of Allah? Should you compromise the deen of Allah to please the disbelievers, to please the enemies of Allah? Of course, the answer is no. The answer is, be steadfast on the deen of Allah. The most valuable thing in our life is what? We need to ask ourselves this question. What is the most valuable thing in our life? The most valuable thing in our life is the belief in Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Is to be steadfast on the deen of Islam. Is to seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. This is the most valuable thing. So if someone trying to take that away from us, how can someone take that away from us? By being disbelievers, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbid. By committing sins, by compromising some of the orders of Allah out of the fear of the enemies of Allah. They try to take away some of this most precious thing in your life, which is matters of iman, matters of faith, to be obedient to Allah. What should we do then? We should not let that happen whatsoever, because they have no means unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permits. So when we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, what would these enemies would take from us? As the people of Fir'aun, the sorcerers, when iman, when faith became into their hearts, they said to Fir'aun, فَقْضِ مَا أَنْتَ قَضْ إِنَّمَا تَقْضِ هَذِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, which means, make whatever decisions you want to make. He's Fir'aun, he's the Pharaoh, he's the tyrant, he's the king, that he can punish them, he can kill them, he can order for whatever he wants. He has the soldiers and the helpers and so on. And these sorcerers, they helpless. They became believers. But what did the iman do to their hearts? They said to him, فَقْضِ مَا أَنْتَ قَضْ, make whatever verdict you want. Why? Because you're only dealing with this life only. And even though this life is owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so you cannot even have ownership of this life. But they understood immediately that they are being faithful, they are being believers, seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, seeking the rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. And having this contentment in their hearts that the disbelievers are not to take from them the most precious thing, the most valuable thing, which is their deen. That's why this is the most important thing in our life. And if the deen of Al-Islam is the most valuable thing in our life, and we read Quran, we see the way the Prophet ﷺ, we would see things in the proper way, and we would put things in the proper context. And accordingly, we would have means of steadfastness. But to think that means of steadfastness is to do some physical things and that's it, we can be easily deceived. Many of us today, we are deceived, whether media is showing us one thing or the other, and because of the effect of sins. Sins makes the person not able to see things in the proper way. And sins after a sin after a sin, and submitting oneself to the ways of the disbelievers and what they are spreading to us in media and so on, then what happens? Then it's easy for the hearts to be diverted from the truth, to follow matters of doubtful matters and matters of even matters of belief. It makes the person compromise the deen of Islam. Instead, we should refer to the orders of Allah in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, indeed, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَوُ الْكُفْرَ بِالْإِيمَانِ. Indeed, those who اشْتَرَوُ, اشْتَرَوْ meaning purchased. And the word اشْتَرَوْ, it's mentioned in the Quran, in Allah اشْتَرَى, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purchased from the believers their lives. When they would fight for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَيَقْتُلُونَ مِقْتَلُونَ, and they would, as a result of that, they would kill and they would be killed. So, purchased. Who purchased what? إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَوُ الْكُفْرَ بِالْإِيمَانِ. Those who purchased al-kufr, they purchased disbelief. بِالْإِيمَانِ, in exchange of al-Iman. There's two things here. When you buy something, when you purchase something, you give something and you take something in change, in exchange of that. And that's why when you value, for example, food, this is a necessity in our life, but you also value your money. Your money is an important thing. Gold, silver, cash, whatever there is. So it's value, and it's valuable. And you won't give it up like this that easy. But because you value the food so much, you want to eat, so you would give the money in change of what? In change of the food, your necessities. And the same thing, people want to live in a house, buy a car, clothes, whatever there is, we would spend from our wealth that we value so much for something in exchange that is so valuable for us. So imagine that someone would exchange what with what? With purchase what? With iman, the most valuable thing? When we talk about the most valuable thing is our iman, is faith. We have to make that decision. It's not something that we would do it sometimes and stay away from it in other times. This is our life as Muslims. The most valuable thing that you would never give it up for anything. There is nothing worth al-Iman. If the whole earth and whatever it contains, all the treasures on the face of earth, life itself, which is the most valuable thing that a person has, everything, anything that you can imagine, that you can see with your own eyes in this life, it's not worth al-Iman. It's not worth even a part of al-Iman. If we have the proper understanding and belief of what iman is. Iman is not just the belief in the heart, actions done by the heart, the speech of the tongue, and the actions by our bodies. So any good deeds, and any bad deeds that we're ordered to stay away from, this matter of al-Iman is not to compromise by anything, is not to be given for anything on the face of earth. So if somebody would tell you, I will give you the kingdom of this earth, I will give you the treasures of this earth, in return of what? Of disbelief, that you would give them, that you would give away your Iman. Is it worth it? Of course not. If it's even the same thing is said, not just the whole Iman, even if it comes to a small sin that you think it's a small thing. Leave just one salah, just in one day, and you can repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after 5 minutes. Leave it for millions and millions. The believers would never give that up whatsoever, because Iman is the most valuable thing in our life, because they understand the purpose of this life, what they're going ahead to the hereafter, and so on. If they are given the whole earth, the whole wealth, to deal with riba, with one penny, with $1, with one whatever currency of usury, of riba, they would never give up that whatsoever. Why? Because this is the deen of Islam, the most valuable thing in our life. When we see our status nowadays as Muslims, willingly, not being even threatened, willingly dealing with haram, dealing with usury, with bribery, with all kinds of cheating, with haram, with looking at something that is haram, with dealing with means of haram, with lying, with backbitings, with whatever there is. For what? What's in return of this? Money, maybe? Some immediate pleasure? All of the earth and whatever it contains, it's not equal to matters of Iman. And this is what we need to be steadfast on, and seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the strength that the most valuable thing in our life is al-Iman. And that's why the ayah says about the disbelievers, see how evil they are and how foolish they are. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَوُوا الْكُفْرَ بِالْإِيمَانِ. They purchased, not Iman, they purchased kufr, disbelief, in return of what? They give up Iman. They give up the most valuable thing in return of having disbelief. لَنْ يَضُرُوا اللَّهَ شَيْئًا. They would never harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whatsoever, shay'an, anything, the slightest thing. As the hadith al-Qudsi, where the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا عِبَادِي إِنَّكُمْ لَنْ تَبْلُغُوا ضُرِّي فَتَضُرُّونِي. O my slaves, you would never reach where you can harm me, and you would harm me. He's the creator of the heavens and the earth. What the human beings can do? Sometimes people, they think this way. If they harm the believers, if they cause sins and the disobedience of Allah, they think that they're hurting the deen of Al-Islam. The deen of Al-Islam is victorious at all times. This whole earth and whatever it contains belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are just living a life of being tested, for the believers to be believers and for the disbelievers to be punished and so on. So those who would purchase disbelief in return of Al-Iman, they would never cause harm to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. And they have a severe punishment for them in the hereafter, waiting for them. So for those who ponder over these verses, and this is the benefit of this, is that the believers, the most valuable thing in their life is al-Iman. And this is what we need to see in the lives of the companions, radiallahu anhum. The most valuable thing in their life is al-Iman. And that's why if we keep repeating this over and over again, we would see this valuable meaning. And the believers, they would purchase al-Iman with their actions, with their belief, for anything in the world. Even if it's their own life. There's no meaning of life without al-Iman. There's no value of anything if we are not steadfast on the deen of al-Islam. And this is what we learn. These are the means of steadfastness. Comes into our hearts with this strength from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the proper understanding of the words of Allah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us benefit from what we hear, and for our actions to be accordingly, and to change our whole entire life according to the way, the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, by reciting the Quran and getting to know the way of the Prophet ﷺ. We continue, inshallah ta'ala, if Allah give us life, with more verses. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.
فلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
فلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا